Good evening, everybody, and thank you for taking time out tonight to come to this great presentation we have in store for you, all about backyard homes in the city of Kitchener. My name is Daniel Hall. I am the founding architect at the Architect Builders Collaborative, but you don't need to know that. What you need to know is that we're here tonight with the Grand Valley Society of Architects, the help from the City of Kitchener and the Kitchener Public Library, our wonderful host, and a slew of fantastic architects and designers in the City of Kitchener. Very, very rich design culture here. People who've done some great designs on backyard homes that we're excited to share with you tonight. Taking over the host duties for the evening, I would like to introduce you to our moderator, Yvonne Ip. Yvonne, raised in Vancouver, born in Hong Kong, and a solo backpacker across several continents, has called Kitchener home for a long time. Yvonne and I have known each other quite a few years, and I can attest that aside from fantastic credentials in architecture, sociology, and visual arts, she's very passionate about a range of social justice issues, in particular, how architects and architecture can help shape the world we live in. Yvonne is proud to be a co-founder of Ontario's very first architectural worker cooperative, ERISE Architects, and she is also currently chair of the Grand Valley Society of Architects. So Yvonne, and I turn the microphone over to you.
Thank you, Daniel. Welcome, everyone. I hear we have quite a crowd out there, so I'm very pleased. And so we're gathered here tonight to, as Daniel said, to hear from a group of wonderful architects in Kitchener who were contestants in the Backyard Homes Competition initiated by the City of Kitchener. And you will be hearing from both the winners, the winner, which includes Daniel's firm, and the honorable mentions. So they're here. They're here for presenting their wonderful designs to us and to whet our appetites to get this movement going. So I will be the moderator, and that really means stepping back and introducing people. I would like now to introduce Adam Clark. He will be our first presenter. Adam is a senior urban designer at the City of Kitchener, where he has worked for the past 8 years in a series of design-related roles. He holds a master's degree in architecture from the University of Waterloo. Adam developed the city's Backyard Homes Design Competition, which is what we're all here for, and is the co-author of the city's new urban design manual, which I think is fantastic. So I'm going to now pass it over to Adam to give us an overview of the competition and the background thereof.
Thanks, Yvonne. Thanks everybody for turning out tonight. I'm looking at the number of participants, and it's a very exciting number to see. And I'm so grateful that there's such strong interest in backyard homes in Kitchener. As Yvonne mentioned, I do work for the City of Kitchener. I'm an urban designer there. I did have the honor of administering the Backyard Homes Competition that so many of these immensely talented designers you're going to hear from tonight participated in. And so I'm grateful to them, and I'm grateful to everybody for that process. It was the first time we've ever run an architectural design competition at the city. So it was kind of a big leap for us, but it worked out so well. We were so excited and so impressed with the quality of the submissions and very, very pleased. So I've been very smartly put at the front end of this presentation because I'm going to go over all of the not boring stuff, but the less exciting stuff for you guys tonight. I'm going to talk about the sort of zoning behind this bylaw, the process, some of the things that you might need to know if you want to build a backyard home on your property. So if we can go to the next slide, please. So the background is that in spring of last year, Kitchener City Council approved a citywide bylaw that legalized additional dwelling units, and that's what we call them sort of technically, ADUs. But they're also known as backyard homes, and sometimes we hear them referred to as tiny homes or laneway homes, granny flats. There's all kinds of names for those things that you might see out there. But they all sort of refer to the same thing. And this zoning that was approved, it applies to all residential properties in Kitchener that are zoned for low-rise development. And so you can see some of the details there in the text on the screen. This zoning applies to about 50,000 properties total in Kitchener. Our analysis suggests that about half of those properties can actually meet all the zoning regulations as of right. So about 25,000 properties are sort of eligible out of the box to build a backyard home in the city of Kitchener. And to promote our new zoning, the city administered this first ever design competition, which was the Backyard Home Design Competition. And we awarded 4 winning entries in 4 categories alongside 20 total honorable mentions. So there was the professional category, and you're going to hear from the professional designers tonight. We also had a student category for post-secondary students. We had a community category for anyone who was just sort of interested or a hobbyist or who might want to build their own backyard home. And then we also had a youth category for younger people. And to date, 20 applications have been made for a backyard home, and 9 of those applications have been approved. None of the applications have been denied. The others are just still in progress, and 7 building permits have been issued thus far. Next slide, please. So why backyard homes? Why is this an important thing, and why is it a valuable thing for us to be implementing at this time? As a lot of you surely know, Kitchener is growing very rapidly. However, in some of our low-rise residential areas, particularly in sort of central older neighborhoods, including some near mass transit, like LRT stations, for example, populations are actually shrinking. And we know that now because the new census data just came into being a couple of weeks ago. So while this is only one tool of many that we use to address housing supply and affordability, there's obviously a sort of full range, a complete suite of things that we need to do to address housing supply and affordability. But backyard homes, so in a sort of unique way, allow for very gentle intensification of low-rise neighborhoods. And they can do that without causing significant or barely even noticeable physical change from the street. And that can be the number one priority of existing residents in certain neighborhoods who really value the character of their neighborhood. Backyard homes also help accommodate a greater range of housing needs within the community. They're a really effective tool for multi-generational families, for persons who want to age in place and stay in their neighborhood as they get older, for independent living for people with special needs. And it can also be a source of income to help offset the price of housing. And that allows for a broader range of people, younger people, sort of different types of family units to enter the housing market when it can be obviously incredibly difficult and expensive to do so today. Next slide, please. So this is a really quick zoning overview of some of the various regulations that are in place that will control the design of backyard homes. So for your lot, you need a minimum lot width of 13.1 meters, a minimum lot area of 395 meters squared. You can do 1 additional dwelling unit per lot. That's a maximum. It must be connected to full municipal services. So that's sanitary, water, et cetera. And it must be located in the rear yard and at least 0.6 meters from any property line. So it's a backyard home in a very true sense that way. For the building height, we have a 4.5 meter height limit, and that's to the midpoint of most styles of roof, so that there's a little bit of design flexibility around the sort of style, whether it's modern or traditional, that can be achieved with our backyard homes. But that height limit is just to sort of keep them from being too noticeable from the street, that kind of thing. Next slide, please. On the topic of setbacks, the primary house, so that's the house that you have currently on your property, that must be set back at least 1.2 meters from each side lot line. So there has to be a side yard of at least 1.2 meters wide for a single detached or a duplex. For street towns or semi-detached dwellings, so that's basically, a row of townhouses, the setback has to be 2.5 meters on one side. And that's really important because you have to provide unobstructed access to the backyard home. It's mostly a fire safety issue, but it's also an accessibility issue. So in addition to those setbacks, you also have to provide a 1.1 meter wide unobstructed path from the public sidewalk or the roadway to the backyard home so that someone can walk there safely and comfortably. The footprint of a backyard home cannot exceed 15% of the total lot area, and the maximum total floor area must be either lower than 50% of the main house's floor area, or 80 meters squared, whichever number is lower. And for parking, so if there are two total units on the parcel, so that would be the primary house and the backyard home, two parking spaces are required. If there are three total units, so you would have a duplex as the main house and then an additional dwelling unit in the form of a backyard home, three parking spaces are required. Also, if your backyard home is within 800 meters of an ION station, so that's our LRT, the backyard home does not require a parking spot, which is a really great feature that we added in. So if we can go to the next slide, there is a really quickly just a map that generally sort of shows you what that radius is from our major transit station area stops. So if you're within the darker gray area there, no additional parking space is required for that backyard home. If you're outside that area, then it does require a parking space. Next slide, please. So how to apply to build a backyard home on your property. Backyard homes are applied for through a scoped site plan process. So the site plan process is a typical process that we run at the City of Kitchener through the Planning Division for basically any type of development. But for this, we've scoped it. So we've removed a lot of the requirements. The cost is $522 and it includes basically the submission of a scoped site plan, which confirms zoning compliance. So you will basically draw your parcel, the main house, and your proposed backyard home. Hopefully you will engage with one of these great professionals to provide that professional service. But then we take that as city staff and we review that plan. We make sure it conforms to the zoning. We make sure that the parking is correct. We look at the elevations, not so much for design, but just to confirm that the building height meets the zoning regulations. And then we'll also be reviewed for building report, building code conformity, make sure that the emergency access is provided correctly and considers impacts for say trees on site. If you want to remove a tree, for example, that's something we would review. And that site plan is approved by planning staff. The application is then reviewed by the building department for the purposes of issuing a building permit. So planning staff review the site plan to grant sort of approval for the planning process, and then building staff review the proposal to issue the building permit to actually begin construction. And the cost of that process does vary. So if the application, additionally, if it cannot meet the zoning, but there are only sort of small items that it can't quite meet, maybe it's 0.5 meters away from the side or the rear lot line when it needs to be 0.6 or something, just, you know, these small variances, a minor variance application can be applied for as well through the Committee of Adjustment. And so the Committee of Adjustment will is a public committee, but it will consider the changes that are proposed. And if they represent good planning and they're considered minor in nature, the Committee of Adjustment will approve the application. So this is an additional public process and there is a fee associated with that. But just to give you an alternative sort of direction in case you're unable to meet the exact specifications of the zoning bylaw on your site, there is still the opportunity to build a backyard home. And you can get started at this website here. So big, long URL. We can maybe post that in the chat for everybody. But that's a good general place to start when it comes to preparing a site plan application for a backyard home. And I think that's all I have. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Adam. Okay, so now we're going to get into the nitty-gritty. And our first presenter is Andre Arsenault, who was a honorable mention for the professional category. I was reminded about that. Thank you to Adam for reminding. In the professional category for the backyard homes competition. And Andre is a licensed architect in the life sciences sector of Merrick, Canada, with 20 years of experience in multidisciplinary design firms and institutions. He has built a diverse experience in the design of various types of healthcare, academic, industrial, commercial, and residential projects. Andre is well experienced in projects that meet capital and research grant budgets and bringing about collaborative and innovative approaches to multi-stakeholder projects. So, without any further ado, Andre, I should have, that, yeah, he was in a picture of backyard. This is Andre. Welcome, Andre.
Yeah, thank you very much. I really appreciate Yvonne for the introduction there. Yeah, so a little bit of an introduction. I do work with Merrick Canada, but I'm also operating my private practice in Portion in the local area here. I've had chances to work in Uptown Waterloo for the last 25 years or so. And I've worked with the University of Waterloo, Stantec in the North Campus, involved with Evolve One there, Neo Architecture out of Kitchener, Walter Fady out of Kitchener, Arise Co-op. I worked with Yvonne for a little bit in Guelph, and as well had the chance to go to Toronto and work for Canon Design and the design architect award-winning Andrew King. And we developed projects out of Montreal for Place Belle and Laval area. I worked with Parmelo and even had the chance to work in Lansdowne, the stadium, the TD place there. And so it's kind of a full circle that I'm now working from home out of Waterloo, but for an office out of Ottawa with Merrick Canada. So if we go to the next slide, Yvonne. So this was the opportunity for us to do a little creative design work on the competition. We're excited about being able to enter it in as a family exercise, as well as my own, testing out of design ideas. So when we saw this opportunity, we were excited about it and wanted to also provide an opportunity to speak to Kiwanis event that was in the fall. And so we tied that together and it was an opportunity to explore affordable housing as well. So we can go to the next slide. The backstory behind this was that we had the idea that a professional musician could, as a professor at University of at Wilfrid Laurier, could have a detached back home with the idea that it could be a guest house for traveling musicians and artists, family and friends. It could be also a private teaching studio, or it could be a short-term rental for Airbnb for whatever they might do. And the location of the site that was chosen is real. It's a friend of ours that lives in Kitchener close to the Spurline Trail and the Via Rail, and that it's probably in that radius of the Ion there. So we did provide enough parking for the two, the main house and the back tiny home. But this was very much an exploration, and we were very excited about the opportunities that came out of it. So if we could move to the next slide. Where it really started out is really the site itself developed a huge kind of informal conversation with us as we tried to understand best where to place this tiny home. The main site is up closer to this, to the main house is closer to the street on the right there. And then we have a garage that's existing at the back, and the ground slopes back probably about a meter and a half to the lowest part at the rear, where there's an existing fire pit in Kitchener. They're able to do fires, outdoor fires. And so there's a nice, beautiful landscaped area there. And we wanted to, so that amphitheater area was kind of the inspirational spot to start off with. And so we hugged the back of the rear lot, and that ended up informing the floor plan immensely. So we did look at the zoning and try to figure out what the ratios would be, and we didn't max out the areas for the lot because the main house was actually small to start with. So it's a small footprint. It's quite an environmental footprint, in my opinion. If we could move to the next slide. So this is the main floor of the living space. And the challenge here was to, again, using the inspiration of music studio, but also having a living space that could be accommodating for guests or for Airbnb. We immediately saw with the limited square footage that we would need to push up to a second floor. But you'll notice from Adam's zoning requirements, the building height is quite restrictive, and I'll get into that a little bit later. So we had to be very creative and innovative on how to get that extra loft space up top. So the main entry and the main space is around a hearth. And we kept that fireplace as a central sort of communal space. And then the kitchen to feed, and as well, the stairway became sort of an articulation of that space and allowed us to kind of explore the volume as a two height space. If we go to the next slide. So you'll see on the left part of the floor plan there, it's open to below, and the staircases are that double volume space. And there's a reason physically as well with that, with the head height clearances being limited as they were. We really had to push where we could start the loft floor plan without getting, you know, into hitting your head and having head clearance problems from a code perspective. So that loft area is really that delineation of the line through the center of the floor plan starts on the right to become where it's livable as a second floor. And the bathroom is a full height bathroom. And we really wanted to celebrate the light coming in from the sort of southeast corner. And developed a plan around this idea that, you know, through the day there would be light filtering through and it would be different through the seasons as well, all the while hugging that back end of the site plan. So the site plan really kind of still is articulated in the floor plan itself with the way that the contour of the property lines, but also just the way that the topography worked itself out. So at this level, you could probably look out just to the existing deck that's beyond and not feel like you're kind of sticking out way above anything. It would definitely be below the roof line of the existing garage even, which is just a one story flat roof garage. Could we go to the next slide? Thank you. So this is here where we explored the idea of like, how do we get that second floor space in there and that volume? The 4,500, you can see here the clearances, you know, if you start taking into account the thickness of a normal, floor assembly, it's very quick that you get limited to how much headspace. The 2150 on the main floor, that's sort of the head height of a normal door, and really at the minimum of what you would expect from a head clearance space. So by doing the shed roof and being able to pop it up above the bathroom and kitchen area on that side and bring in the light from that level, it really allowed us to just play around with how much height we could gain. So we did really push the envelope for that 4,500 max roof height by, you know, tilting it down and getting a ratio that we got an average that was 4,500, but at the highest point, it was actually 5,500 meters. If we could go to the next slide. Big part of this was also the idea that the existing deck that's there in the garage is sort of an existing hosted area in the summer. We wanted to explore how do we get the living space to expand out to the outdoors during the summer. We did some renderings that kind of showcased an amphitheater environment where you could start to have people sitting and really play with the topography of like having, you know, the half circle spread itself up and you could have like a stage performance happening. And it's because it's a natural bowl in the earth, it would be great for the sound. You'd have the back of the house itself becoming a sort of a reflection. You could get some good reverberation going on and it wouldn't be an interruption necessarily to the neighbors that are surrounding her because it was so well sort of sub the level of the street by again, that 1.5 meters or so to bottom level. So we were really happy with how this just naturally kind of comes together and is all tied together as a sequence. You know, you come from that street where you're parked and your double tandem spaces, and then you kind of feel like it's a natural environment. There's some beautiful existing trees that are there, quite large, and provides a great shaded area in the back. If we go to the next slide.
Okay, Andre, I'm sorry to have to jump in here, and just so that our audience knows, this is kind of, I don't know how to say it, Pika, chick. Anyways, quick formats. So you had 6 minutes and your time is up.
Oh, okay. I thought it was at 5 minutes still. All right. We're good to go then. You can scroll through. That was the last slide actually. So
okay.
This was is just any, a poster.
Just like a couple of sentences to wrap up.
You know, I really enjoyed the opportunity for the design competition. It was exciting and fun. So we played with it and it was a great experience. And I'm hopeful that, you know, we'll get to see some great creative projects coming through from this zoning change. So great. Thank you for the opportunity.
Okay. Thank you, Andre.
Thanks, Yvonne.
Okay. Next up, we will have Cyrus Medina. And a bit of introduction for Cyrus. Cyrus is passionate about building structures that make an impact on the community. He believes that cities continually grow in terms of spatial dimensions driven by economic activity. Cyrus believes that the lack of affordable housing is a very serious problem, and it is. And solutions may come not just from big developments, but also through simple and practical, straightforward solutions. So, Cyrus, straightforward solutions you shall present in 6 minutes.
Okay, so this is my design entry. It's basically cabin evolved, as everyone here all knows that Kitchener has a housing shortage. My background, since I moved to Canada 5 years ago, I've worked with developers in Kitchener Waterloo area. I currently now work in Guelph with one of the developers there. But with that, I've always thought of housing as an integral part of each family, not necessarily just for them to stay home, right? Other people here, when I was talking to one of my neighbors, they were actually thinking of having a backyard home as something like a simple rental space, right? This is my vision for that space. If you could move to the next slide. Thank you. So the property I'm looking at is one near St. Mary's Hospital. It's in Patricia Avenue. As you can very well see, that this lot has a really deep lot. So there's a lot more potential improvements at the back. Speaking to the neighbor that was discussing with me, they were actually getting to that stage where they want to retire, and they view their property as they don't want to move. Just to simplify things, they will still want to own the lot and have an additional income when they retire. Now, with that, I see the way to solving some of our housing shortage, basically, instead of using traditional rooms, I would use pocket spaces. I'll show you in the floor plan later. Another one that I would use is alfresco version. Basically, even though the footprint of the room itself is limiting, I'd like to use an outdoor space to extend the indoor, or to extend the usage of that housing or that backyard house. Now, bear in mind that Canada has winter season, so that may be limited to at least, 2 weeks in a year. But of course, everyone, with weather changing, hopefully it becomes longer. The other one I'd like to use is captured light. Now, again, smaller area, smaller footprint. I don't want to riddle it with windows in all of in all the elevations, so that I'd like to concentrate the windows or the openings in one area, as long as it follow the building code. So you can see in this slide that the site would be at the back, highlighted in blue. Next slide, please. This is the floor plan. So when I say cabin evolved, basically we start off with just one module, and we can replicate that same module if it's needed. So I'm looking at the base plan on the left side. You would just have a pocket bed area. Living, dining, and kitchen area would be combined in this area, and a very basic toilet and bath or bath area. The back portion would be a patio, which can be used during summertime, even in the fall. Now, when the need arises, or for example, the student or the main owner of the house decides to have his house rented, they could actually use the exact same layout on the right portion. And basically, you would have, again, additional beds. You just need to adjust the spaces in there. The portion at the back would become like an open porch. The back would still be the patio, and you would have an additional bath or toilet and bath for your bedroom. You can see that it's not it's very basic compared to what developers could show you or could possibly have you rent out or sell to you. But I think having this, because I came from Southeast Asia, wherein we don't have that much space compared to Canada, right? So wise usage of space is very integral for this. And it has to be also flexible for future use. So it can't be limited to just a base layout. If it needs to, it has to be able to evolve with the owner or whoever ends up using the space. Next slide. Thank you. So last thing I forgot to mention in the concept of this was space, eco-aware. So I would put some solar panels on top. Again, we all know solar panels is constantly upgrading. So hopefully by the time some of this are built, it would be able to support the requirements of each of this house or each of this backyard homes. So again, the way of construction, every time I do something, it always has to be simplified construction. So finishes, it's readily available right now. You don't have, it's basically engineered wood siding. It's available in Home Hardware or any other suppliers. Outside, glazing units, we don't have that much window opening. I opted to concentrate it on the left side and the front side. There's one for the rear, which is the bath. And yep, anything else? The back portion, wherein it's a trellis patio area, I envision it to be like already engineered wood, or trellis area should be engineered wood and prefabricated if possible. So simple uses of space and easily constructible. I think it's a more practical way in hopefully alleviating housing problems in Kitchener-Waterloo, as well as helping the owner of the house, whether they want it rented out for Airbnb, student housing, whatever the owner wants.
Yep. Thank you, Cyrus.
That's it. Thank you very much.
Great, thank you. Okay, next up we have Graham Whiting. And a bit about Graham. He's an architect with extensive experience in green building and permaculture design for residential, commercial, and institutional projects. He's also a lead professional, passive house and net zero designer. He's been the principal and owner of Whitefish Architecture since 2004. Graham has comprehensive knowledge of energy efficiency, IAQ, water and energy management, building envelope and passive solar design. He has taught environment and business for SMEs at the University of Waterloo's new SEED School, and has a particular interest in applying regenerative economy thinking to small businesses. Graham currently volunteers with Indigenous communities of Southern Ontario working on housing sovereignty issues. So without further ado, welcome to Graham.
Thanks, Yvonne. Wonderful introduction. And welcome everyone. Yeah, I think we have a pretty good turnout here, so that's pretty cool. Lots of interest. Love this concept, and I really applaud Adam and the City of Kitchener for bringing this forward. Let's get the City of Waterloo on board too, and maybe a couple other municipalities. Keep pushing for these sorts of things. Let your politicians know, because this type of what we're calling soft density is really, I think, a critical missing piece in our whole sort of, you know, healthier urban fabric, good affordable housing, the idea of moving smaller and sort of opening up our idea of what a single family home lot can look like and can actually do for the community. So I just love this initiative. I'm looking forward to doing a lot more of these. So the one we're looking at here, we've dubbed it Little City Cottage. It's going to be on a property that was formerly known as Little City Farm. A couple of you might be familiar with that name. So this is a small dwelling unit for a mother who's moving in to be closer to her grandchildren. So classic, like we want to call it, the granny flat. It's basically allowing multi-generational use of the property, where primarily single family zoning doesn't often permit for that. This is a really great way to have somebody have that autonomy living in the backyard, but be very close to the family. So I'm not sure if you can see what I'm gesturing on the screen here, but I'm gonna do it and hopefully that shows up for you. So we've got basically a large volume, which is the primary living space in the front, and then a smaller volume on the back with these opposing sloped roofs, keeping it all very low to the ground, as low to the ground as possible for accessibility, and keeping that very low profile, again, for that not wanting to get too high, towering over neighborhood properties, and just an appropriate scale for the whole thing. We've got a lot of windows, nice bright southeastern orientation for a great brightly lit living space. And then around the back, a little more private, a little more secluded for bedroom and bathroom and that sort of thing. So could you go to the next slide, please? And I'll show you the layout of that. So on the right-hand side, we've got our site plan. The lighter brown is the dwelling unit in question. So we've got the main house, kind of the sprawling larger rectangle towards the front of the property. The street is kind of a curving street towards the front. Lots of gardens to the right-hand side, and a couple of sheds. And then we've tucked it in the back corner behind the house. So we have nice walkway access past the house, as well as easy access for servicing, which is often a challenge with these type of dwellings. They do require servicing that will run through the existing house or tie into the services in front of the existing house to be able to carry through to the street. It's an interesting little detail with these additional dwelling units, but they are not permitted to have a second connection to city water or city sewers. So it's all got to tie together into one. Now looking at the floor plan, on the left-hand side, we have the main entrance, the front door, up a couple of short steps into a small area, which is a closet at the front door, behind that a laundry, and behind that again, service area that will also host a future stairway that will go up to a loft space above that. And moving to the right, you can see the yellow chairs sitting at an island in the kitchen. So decent sized kitchen, L-shaped, and then out into the living room. So we're economizing on size here, 700 square feet total for the entire floor plate. And so your kitchen island is doubling as the dining table in this instance, and then decent sized living space allowing for a full size couch and chairs and so on. Tucked in behind that, you've got your bedroom, clothing, closet storage off to the side of that, and then off of that bedroom would be a four-piece bath. So we have a flush walk-in shower, a nice tub, sink, and some storage in there as well. So packing a lot into a small package, 700 square feet, you're getting a decent sized living room that can fit a king. You've got a four piece bath, you've got a laundry. It is definitely possible in a small package like this. Could you go to the next slide, please? Here are technical drawings. We went for a permit on this a couple of months ago. It's now under construction. So again, here's your floor plan on the left-hand side. You want to dig in for a little more detail there. And then the section beside that. So we've got a very heavily insulated building envelope. On the upper part of this section, you can see we've created a small loft area inside the slope of the roof. And that is reflected in the small floor plan below that. It's labeled as a storage area to get us through permit, but I imagine that you might find a grandchild or two sleeping up there in the cool little loft from time to time. Don't tell anybody. And then another really great detail on this that we're pretty excited about is for backyard dwellings in particular, excavation can be a real challenge. You need to get like heavy equipment back there if you can't get a large excavator back there, you're doing it with a small excavator and, you know, getting in frost footings and so on, you're basically going to absolutely obliterate the whole backyard. So in this instance, we've used helical piers. Could you go to the next slide, please, and I'll show you exactly what that looks like. So on the left-hand side, you've got a photograph of what that looks like from the foundation's perspective. We've got the helical piers that were just driven directly into the ground. No muss, no fuss, no excavation. And then on the right-hand side, I'm showing you the layers of what we've done for an insulated floor, which is a real challenge for this type of construction. So the pink is a layer of rigid foam insulation. And then above that, we've got 16-inch cavities filled with voxel that will give you a really well-insulated floor. Again, with no foundation wall, no excavation, just the whole thing sitting right up above the ground. Next slide. And then here our wall section. So we've got an R60 roof, an R40 wall, an R60 floor as well. So here we're getting into insulation levels that are exceptionally well insulated, well above code. And so the heating and demands for a house of this size would be absolutely minimal. We can do it with a small heat pump. And then, you know, innovating with the way that this type of insulated floor is built and set on steel beams on helical piers, I think we've come up with some details here that can really lend themselves to effectively putting these small homes into tight situations and tight backyards. That should be about it for my time, I think. Hopefully there's some questions, and please feel free to reach out to me through the links provided or through my website, that sort of thing as well. Happy to talk backyard homes with anyone anytime. Thanks.
Thank you, Graham. Yes, and perfect timing. And just a reminder to the to the attendees, the audience, there is a Q&A box that you can enter questions in that we'll be able to, we should be able to get to them at the end of the program. Okay, so next up we have a duo. It's Krista. Sorry, I'm just... Krista Toman and Ilhan Odzemir. Sorry, I hope I pronounced that correctly. So Krista is the principal designer and passionate owner of Toman Interiors, located in Guelph, Ontario. Since graduating with high honors from Sheridan College in 2018, Krista has had the privilege of bringing a fresh eye to a wide variety of design projects, including full home builds, large-scale renovations, along with home and commercial decorating. With several publications and an award under her belt, Krista continues creating immaculate spaces with while growing in the industry. Toman Interiors has a special love for working with young seniors that wish to age in place gracefully, and guides, educates them through this important journey of comfort and independence. And for Ilhan, a bit about him. Ilhan's design career started after attending the Pratt Institute summer program in 2010, graduating from the International Baccalaureate Diploma Program in 2012, he pursued his passion for design through architecture, enrolling in the University of Waterloo School of Architecture co-op program. He graduated with honors in 2017 and then returned to the University of Waterloo for his graduate studies. And he has recently earned his Master's of Architecture degree. That was in January 2021. Congratulations, Ilhan. You're off to a great start. And speaking of start, here we go.
Okay, good evening. My name is Krista and this is Ilhan.
Hi everyone.
So can you see us okay and hear us? Everything's good?
Yep.
Perfect. Okay, so we decided to take two main approaches to this design. The first one being multi-generational living, and the second one being maintaining the city heritage.
So in this first slide, you see an overall image of our proposal. We believe Kitchener has some beautiful brick buildings. So we thought this competition was actually a really good opportunity to explore this material in the residential context and push the envelope a bit on it. So our design consists one bedroom unit with a carport and a perimeter shading, which provides some shading for the front porch area that's an exterior socializing space. Next slide, please.
Okay, so taking a look at the interior here, you would enter off the side of the house. And then right away, it's just a really bright, wide open space. You have your one wall kitchen to the right, and then sort of a bar style dining area with a large living room. And then we've created a bit of a room divider with a bookcase and some storage, as well as a working station. You can go to the next slide. So just a few more views showing that it's a one bedroom and then a three piece bath to the left there. And we really wanted to focus on the windows. We decided to go with this approach just to take full advantage of all the natural light coming in while still like providing enough wall space for the clients to use. And it also just adds to their privacy. Next slide. So this one is looking more at the floor plan. And this is where we were really considering the multi-generational living and how it can all be made wheelchair accessible. So right now surveys are saying that 78% of seniors are wanting to age in place, but 28% are finding that's not feasible for many different reasons. But the two highest reasons are usually their home is just not set up safely for that, and financially they're not able to do it. So a backyard home is a really good solution for this age group because they can either be with their families, you know, on the same plot. It just reduces the stress financially for all members of the family, as well as just maintaining the older couple's independence so they can still have their own space there.
Next one, please. So in conclusion, our two goals were to meet our potential clients' ever-changing needs in their lifestyle, downsizing, having that flexibility attached to this extension to their main lots and their main house, while still having a sensitive approach to the kitchen heritage and cultural identity of Kitchener through the materiality of the architecture and a bit of that industrial look. And we really enjoyed experimenting with how we can push this material and use a contemporary style and just see what happens. And it was an amazing opportunity. And we believe there's a lot of space to explore in this context. Thank you.
Yeah, we appreciate the opportunity and we're happy to answer some questions. And more specifically, if you want to talk more about like aging in place, you can just visit the Toman Interiors website. Thank you.
Thank you, Toman, and I'm sorry, Krista and Ilhan. It kind of shows that you're emerging architects because your presentation skills are very spot on. which is something I know you have to do a lot in your studies. So thank you. Next, we have Matt Bolin of Edge Architects. Hang on, here we go. And about Matt, Matt is one of the founding partners of Edge Architects in Waterloo, Ontario. Edge's portfolio encompasses a wide range of project types from a diverse client base. Matt's area of expertise is multi-residential building design. His work experience ranges from mid-rise affordable attainable housing to high-rise condominiums. His professional interests include modular prefabrication, mass timber construction, and high performance energy efficient design. In addition to being a licensed architect with the Ontario Association of Architects, Matt is a certified passive house designer and has prior experience as both an energy auditor and small building contractor. Further to his role as a principal at Edge, Matt is a lecturer at the University of Waterloo School of Architecture for the graduate level architectural practice, professional practice course. Matt is himself a graduate of Waterloo Architecture, where his master's thesis was focused on urban revitalization of mid-sized cities using Kitchener-Waterloo as a case study city. So it's fantastic that Matt stayed. So Matt, take it away.
Great, thank you, Yvonne. And I will definitely try to abide by your 6 minute limit. If anything, I'd like to stay under it because I'm sure it already sounds like we got a lot of interesting questions. So without delay, thank you very much everyone for being here. I specifically want to give, again, very similar to Graham, kudos to Adam for getting this thing off the ground. We've had a few conversations and I think it's a really amazing and inspiring process to see all the people here presenting, as well as all the people here listening and asking questions. So again, as Graham mentioned, I think this is a much, much needed tool in the toolkit in terms of dealing with the housing shortage, housing crisis, as we, I think, are now calling it. And I'm just very excited to be involved and add anything I can. Specifically, also want to thank Yvonne and Anna, actually, who we're going to hear from last, but definitely not least, for both their role in this in design in the communities, but also their active role in the GVSA, Grand Valley Society of Architects, all the great work you do and time you commit there, as do many others on the executive and that are involved in the profession here locally. So kudos definitely there. For us and why we chose to talk about this today in terms of a time lapse is because of the integration that we have at our firm at Edge for looking at residential across a broad spectrum, even that the housing continuum, as it's often referred to by CMHC and others, is often referred to in terms of the demographic that it's providing housing for, from, you know, shelter to supportive housing and affordable housing, and then up the scale to, you know, your more market rate rental, condominiums, and then single family housing and all those sorts of things. That's a continuum that way. But what we're looking to do with our, you know, abilities and understanding of design and construction is to actually start looking at it as a scale. So from as small as what we're talking about here, backyard homes, up through into single family, mid-rise, that missing middle, and then up into the high rise. And I think it's important that we understand and something that we're trying to push on is each one of those different types and scales of housing is an important tool in this toolkit that we're gonna need if we wanna really make an impact. So there's certain areas of our cities, urban corridors, urban nodes, where, you know, a higher density form is more appropriate. But definitely once we get into our established low-rise residential areas, that becomes much less appropriate and starts to have a very detrimental effect. Can start to create things like NIMBYism, but also start to create actual challenges and issues in terms of shading, shadows, overlook, wind, and various other factors. And just, you know, the character of those, again, particularly the established neighborhoods. So going back, I think the backyard is something that's really important, that ability to add that 1+1 density across a broad spectrum, as Adam said, 25,000 homes. I mean, that's an amazing opportunity right there that would take actually quite a few mid-rise or even high-rise projects to make that kind of dent. So again, very excited about it. The time lapse here is talking about our ability, and I think our, what I would say is leadership and us being a bit of, you know, forward thinking in this regard, because we've been thinking about this and started getting actively involved back in about 2017. And it wasn't really by accident. It was specifically based on one of the really amazing relationships we have with a very amazing group that does supportive services in our region called KW Habilitation. And they're a really amazing group. We'd worked with them on their headquarters as well as some mid-rise affordable housing projects. But they and the people they support actually are also living in lower rise environments throughout the city. So we started to look at those and try to figure out if there was a way that we could come up with something in terms of a 1+1 density. So this is, you know, again, 4 years before what Adam and the city have come out with, we were trying to look at it. So if we go to the next slide, this is where we came up with this idea of a modular ADU, so accessory dwelling unit or backyard home. And that was for an existing property that KW Habilitation had on Frederick Street in Kitchener. So what we were able to do, if we go to the next slide, was work with a local modular building provider called Zed Modular, and they were looking to set up a shop locally. We were looking at using their system and integrated it actually into the mid-rise built form. So a mid-rise affordable housing project we were doing with KDPAB, we were looking to use this system. But we thought maybe we can use this system as a prototype for doing the backyard home on their site. So next slide. We actually took the site and although that steel frame that we were just looking at was very robust. And frankly, it's actually overkill for what we were doing here. We knew that, but we were really just trying to use it as a prototype, use it as a way to start to understand some of the logistical challenges that go into putting these backyard units in. And if we look at the top left here, we see this large concrete truck. That was definitely a major challenge. So Graham, I totally agree after going through this process that any ways you can look to minimize the impact of footing and foundation work is definitely a great idea. And some other questions that I think have already come up in the chat relate to servicing. In this case, that was another big challenge on this particular project that we learned from. And I think something that's going to come up as we start to actually execute a lot of these backyard home opportunities is looking not so much, I don't think it's a demand problem, because if you're only really adding one person or one family unit onto these sites, that's not really going to be a big problem in the established residential areas we have. If you even think, you know, back in the 50s, when we were having homes with 8 or 10 people in it, and now, you know, the typical is more 4 or 5. So load that way, I don't think is much of an issue. However, the ability to piggyback off that existing house, I think, is going to be important, and coming up with efficient and effective ways to do that, particularly with the sanitary, is something that we're actively digging into now in terms of looking for nice ways to streamline that process. This was, again, our prototype that helped us uncover some of these challenges and start to deal with them. So next slide. So again, you can see the finished product we were very proud of. The user has I believe, either one or two individuals there now that are actually being able to take use of the house. We did, and as you saw from some of the concrete structures that we did, we actually built this before there was actual backyard designation. And so we ended up doing this as an attached structure off the house. So essentially more of a classified addition, but we're really obviously trying to push those boundaries for what that meant. And it's really, that's why it's so inspiring now to have, you know, conversations with Adam and discussions, and then see that we've made this great step forward, I think, to help making it more accessible and easier to do. Next slide. So from there, we've actually, and I'll go through these ones quite quickly, over the last 2 years, this is actually a project that's in Kitchener that I believe was one of the first. My time is up already. That's unfortunate. Okay, so we can flick through these two. Next slide. I'll finish off in 30 seconds here, Yvonne. So the first two were just two quick ones we did. Again, those are things that are actively out there and currently being constructed. So we're excited about those. And then the last piece was actually our submission for this project, which was drawing on, if we go to the next slide, a mass timber multi-residential affordable housing project we did. This is 4 stories. It's on Blockline Road for YWKW. So essentially providing transitional housing for women battling with homelessness. And as you can see, this is where we were able to utilize mass timber. And now that's where we're really looking to start to depart and work on our next standard and what was the basis for our submission for this competition. Next slide. Next slide again. And again. And again. Is this design here. And this design tries to take some of that building technology that we used, break it down into a kit of parts that can actually work really functionally well for a backyard application. If we go to the next slide, you can see a floor plan. Next slide. Again, just a rendering. And final slide. You can see some of our site analysis. Sorry, one more. Just again, goes into that kit of parts type of building application that we're looking to do here. So might be one more. Yes. Again, some of our cladding options. So the design here, I think we've seen a lot of amazing designs and opportunities. And I think the even as Adam said, the opportunities for design here are endless and oftentimes going to be tied to people's own personal preferences on any given home. So I think that's where hopefully our industry, architects throughout the region who are obviously excited in this, can help and apply our knowledge of construction and some of the execution methods to try to be very successful in this endeavor. So. That's all for me. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt. Yours could have gone on. I see.
Yes. Well, that was the basics. I can always answer specific questions. So
yeah. So
I want to see Anna.
Yeah, there are questions. People can ask questions, and also this webinar is being recorded and will be available on demand through KPL eventually. So if you wanted to get a better look at everything, that's where you would go. So our final panelist is Anna Gascon-Marco. She is with the Architects Collaborative, and they produced the winning submission. And a bit about Anna. Anna is a licensed architect with the Ontario Association of Architects, and she also is a certified passive house designer. Anna, she has been involved in a wide range of projects, including multi-unit and single residential buildings, commercial, institutional, and interior fit-out projects. Her approach to sustainable strategies focuses on creating healthy and functional buildings, commercial, Her approach to sustainable strategies focuses on creating healthy and functional buildings with special interest in developing affordable housing strategies with low energy demand. Actively involved in the architectural community, Anna is a board member of the Grand Valley Society of Architects and with the Ontario Natural Building Coalition, as well as she is a member of the Workplace Sector Committee with Climate Action Waterloo Region. Okay, great. We will have Anna now next to present the winning project.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Yvonne. Hopefully you can hear me well. I don't see me.
Loud and clear.
Okay, perfect. first of all, thank you. Thank you for Yvonne for the introduction, but also City of Kitchener, as some of my other fellow have already mentioned, for putting together this competition. I think it's a great initiative and a lot of good can come from this. So if you can move to the next slide, Yvonne. So as is already mentioned, all of these entries were for this call for submissions from the City of Kitchener. And the competition, it was encouraged to choose a site that it was a real site, first of all. It was encouraged to choose either a natural feature or close to a cultural heritage or a public space. So we chose this specific location due to its proximity to a very well-known public park. Next slide, please. So the first thing that we did in our office was to brainstorm. So we all got together in the boardroom. We had so much fun doing this. And we basically tackled all the different criteria from the competition, but also all other things that we find that are important, like sustainability, accessibility, what else, lower carbon design and energy efficiency. And the end result was GAGA, was the Green Accessible Granny ADU. Next slide, please. So we created a very simple site plan that you can see there on the right side to make sure that the design would comply with all the zoning regulations, being like setbacks, heights, maximum lot coverage, all of that Adam already covered at the earlier on the, tonight. But at the same time, we use that to inform our building of what would be the best locations for openings and why not. So we paid close attention to the location being next to the public part, but also the actual orientation that you see there on the site plan. And also we thought of creating like a semi-private outdoor space, which is that space that you see covered with that trellis on the perspective. And that just provides like a buffer space between the main dwelling and the proposed ADU. That you can see there on the site plan. And I think that for this, the area we maxed it out because the main house was pretty big. So we maxed it out almost to the 80 square meters almost. Next slide, please. So as mentioned earlier, some of the things that we looked at was accessibility and affordability. The circles that you see there on the floor plan, they represent the 1.5 meters radius. So that's something we make sure that somebody on a wheelchair could very well use this unit, this house, this backyard home. But also the bathroom has a flash shower. So it's more like a wet room than a regular bathroom. And the kitchen also, it was thought like as a linear kitchen without ins and outs. So it's also very easy to use with open lower cabinets, oven at counter height, those sorts of things. Next slide, please. In order to make the backyard home even more affordable, the house has a very simple and compact form, which would also have this loft space that you see on the right side. And that is just a bonus space that could use either as an office, storage, or maybe even as a second bedroom. That so this could really be used for a small family. Next slide, please. To keep the costs down and also to provide a very energy efficient and low carbon solution, the cladding materials used were vertical wood siding in most of the elevations and metal siding on the sloped roof and north elevation. Also the number and size of windows was also thought. Mainly we had larger windows toward the south elevation as you see there and smaller windows on the north, east and west elevations. Next slide, please. The strategies for sustainability and energy efficiency, they kind of like overlap, being some of them, the items that we thought that they were important to capture, being like low carbon materials. So as I mentioned, like wood siding and also wood stats for the assembly that we'll look in a minute. We provided a very tight envelope, so no air leakages or thermal breaks. There is a lot of insulation for this house. It's kind of like Graham already mentioned earlier. Triple glazed windows were also provided here. The location of like overhangs mainly on the southern part of the elevations just to block that sunlight whenever we don't want it. And because these would be so energy efficient, it would again be just heated with like a air source heat pump. So very easy to heat. No, it doesn't take too much energy. Next slide, please. As I mentioned, the wall section, I think it would, yeah, oh, it says in there, it's almost an R55 for the wall. The roof, it was slightly thicker and I believe it was R60. So very, very well insulated, way above what it's the minimum required by the OBC, the Ontario Building Code. Next slide, please. The south elevation, as I mentioned, we would have the larger openings to look towards that outdoor space that it was semi-private. All windows except for the north-facing windows would have some sort of like sun protection items, so either movable exterior shutters and also the trellis. So even though it's not shown here, something that we thought that it would be cool is to provide a retractable awning on that trellis to just to block some of the sunlight whenever it's not needed. Next slide, please. So we did a preliminary study to know how much energy would be generated on this specific location. So after doing several iterations, we settled with this one, which was the low roof south racking with regular photovoltaic panels, like PV panels, and only over the slope roof. So there is a flat portion, which would be kept as a green roof. And it will annually produce 6.2 megawatts hour. So as seen in the bars diagram, most of that would happen in the summer months. And on the diagram on the right side, we can see also there is some loss of 14% loss of irradiance loss, and it's mainly to all the shading from the tree coverage. Next slide. So if we do some quick calculations, the amount of energy produced, which was the 6,246 kilowatt hour, if we divided that by the area, we have slightly over 100 kilowatt hour per square meters, which exceeds the 75 kilowatt hour of that you can see circled in that chart there. So if like looking at these results, we can conclude that provided these buildings is were designed according to this low, PHI low energy building standard, the energy produced will be more than the energy required for its operation. So for the operation is both the annual heating, but also the generation of domestic hot water. So maybe in this case, net marine would be an option. So this is my last slide. Thank you very much for being here. And I'll pass it to you, Yvonne, for the Q&A, I guess. Thank you.
Great, thank you, Anna. Yes. Now we can open it up to questions, and thank you to all the panelists for breezing through this presentation and for your wonderful designs and for the inspiration. So a lot of questions have come in and I'm going to work through them in the next 20 minutes or so. Are we able to get the panelists to show their faces at least? And then I will appoint questions to whomever I see fit. So.
Can you go to the next slide too, Yvonne, sorry.
Yeah, sorry, here we go. Okay, so there actually are a lot of questions here that I can lump into one and I'll give everyone a chance to respond. So cost, everyone wants to know about cost. How much does it cost? So I'm gonna start with, I'm just gonna go through who's on my screen first, and that's Matt. So Matt, can you tell us since yours was an actual build, how much did it cost? Can you reveal that to us?
Can I be first for another question instead of that one?
Okay.
So the cost is obviously right now a very complicated issue in this industry generally. So so the easy answer is it'll be by far the cheapest the sooner you do it. So the sooner you do it, the cheaper it'll be. All joking aside, I think there is quite a range, even within the projects and the designs we just saw tonight, there's probably a really broad range of costs. It's easiest most often to talk about things in terms of square footages. I think right now giving yourself, let's say $200 a square foot as a bit of a baseline is probably a smart idea. And that can go obviously up very quickly. And particularly with the small projects, it can go up really fast. So I think the best strategy I can give again is really trying to make sure that with your team of whomever is involved in the project, have a really good plan for how you're, because the build costs of the actual structure itself is one thing, but there's other costs like the servicing, like the foundations, and those things on these small projects can get out of hand really quickly. So, you know, Graham, I think with some of your experience actually having built a couple and with some of the things we're doing, that's probably the best I could give.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I think that what I heard there was around $200 per square foot, and the sooner the better, because yeah. Things are going up. So
can I jump in, because this comes up, sorry Yvonne, this comes up a lot. We've done a number of laneway projects in Toronto and working on some garden suites as well, and $200 on a very, very big building, even that's low. We are literally seeing cost range for built structures somewhere between 300,000 and upwards of 500,000 for very large buildings. I'm talking of 1600 square foot, twice what Kitchener allows. So I think we talk project budget, not construction cost, what you actually have to spend when you're done. And I'd always caution people to go in high and be pleasantly surprised than to go in too low and not be able to afford to finish the project. We'd hate to see that happen. So I don't like square foot when it's a small project. The first square foot costs 10 times as much as the last one. But I think the key is it is going to be far, far cheaper than buying a condominium of the same size square footage, like half the price.
Mm-hmm. And I might also say, I'm going to conjecture here, that there is a return on investment, because I heard a few of our panelists mention that these units can serve as rental suites as well. So does anyone else have something to add? Maybe you have something more economical?
I just want to add, it's also important to team up with a contractor earlier on than later if you can. Even a design build scenario can help sometimes, because we are dealing with, you know, the pandemic and the market and the way it is, the timelines are going to become really stretched, more than a normal pre-COVID scenario. And it's really something that came about in an event we did in the fall. We had a contractor as one of the panelists as well, talking about the tiny homes. And there's things that you don't expect would actually take like 6 month lead or something like that. I have a project that I just finished off, and it took a year and a half for the garage door to come in. So it's really crazy right now, the market. But in addition to costs, you have to really schedule in time as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Another series of questions I think I can also lump into one has to do with the outdoor space that gets incorporated, that can be incorporated. Are there, the porch area that we saw in several of them. So what are the limitations? Are they included in the minimum or maximum square footage? Are they also subject to setback compliances, et cetera? And who had that? I guess it might be Adam. Adam would be the one to answer that one.
Sure. Yeah. So that's a great question. Generally speaking, outdoor spaces do not count against the floor area of the backyard home at all. It's really only interior living space that contributes toward that size maximum. I believe that the setback requirements would probably still apply, although I'm not certain about that. And generally speaking, all of the sort of fire access and access requirements would still certainly apply regardless of the outdoor space. But the good news is that there can be sort of significant outdoor spaces associated with the backyard home that do not count towards that size maximum.
Good. Okay. Adam, again for you, and this is an interesting one. It has to do with basements. Are they allowed in these backyard homes? And if so, what are there requirements for natural light / windows glazing to these basement spaces? And I don't think any of our projects included a basement, so this is something that would be of interest, I think, to everyone.
For sure, yeah. Basements are allowed. And interestingly enough, basement square footage also does not count against the total available square footage. So it's a good way to make up some extra space if you'd like a larger backyard home than what the bylaw allows. As far as windows, I mean, that would be subject to building code requirements for natural light. So depending on what type of use is in that basement, that may or may not require windows. And exit stairs to the basement, I think would be allowed. But basically what you'd have to do is sort of meet our criteria for what's considered a basement. So we'd have certain measurements within the zoning bylaw, not within the ADU bylaw, but within the general regulations of the bylaw that would say that, you know, your basement level can only come so far above grade before it's not considered a basement anymore and it's now considered a ground floor. But those are pretty typical things that all of these architects would be able to guide you on and provide you advice for and walk you through the building code requirements for that kind of thing.
Great. Yeah, I think basements, if basements are allowable, then that's great because it just adds more space. Okay, so one question for Graham. I don't know if he's on, I can't see. Are you there?
I am.
You are, okay, good.
I can't see myself, but I think I'm here.
Yeah, it's a little bit strange when you can't see yourself. Okay, so the question for you is, can you speak more about the helical piles as a foundation option? How does the cost compare to excavating? How many are needed? Thanks.
Well, how many are needed is based on the design. So that's a structural question. How many structural points do you need? Are you using steel or wood to span between the helical piers? There's all sorts of related questions to that. So you could assume that you're going to need somewhere between 6 to 12 for a small backyard dwelling, but don't quote me on that. As far as what's involved, it's actually a fairly small machine. Like, you can mount it to a bobcat as an attachment, and you're basically just driving these large steel screws into the ground. Typical depth of around 7 or 8 feet is based on the amount of friction you get when you get down there. But some areas, in fact, a couple of the piers that we did for the project that I presented, we had to go down closer to 16 feet because that area was, I guess, fairly swampy at one point in its history. As far as cost comparison, we've used them for additions, we've used them for small dwellings, actually used them very recently for a 2,500 square foot home. And in that instance, the contractor felt that they had saved around $60,000 to $70,000 on the overall cost on the foundation. Now that's, you know, obviously not having a basement, but that would be in comparison to doing something like a 4-foot stem wall with traditional footings and then a poured concrete perimeter. On the scale of a small dwelling like this, if you can save $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, that's a lot of money. And I'll just jump in on the earlier question around cost. Custom residential in Kitchener-Waterloo, we are using $400 a square foot. That's COVID pricing. It's crazy, but that's where it's at. And on a small dwelling like this, you don't really get any economy of scale. You've still got a kitchen, you've still got a washroom, you've still got four walls and a roof. And so that sort of extra space might cost a lot less per square foot in a larger dwelling is all compressed down. So definitely start with $400 a square foot as your budget cost. And that would also then not include things like servicing costs, paying your architect, various other things. That's good.
Thank you, Graham. Okay, a question for Matt, actually. If I can find it again. Ah! What was the outcome for your project for the sanitary issue? Did you end up tying into the main house's sanitary?
Good question. The basement question was a good one too. We sort of not, but basically the problem with that one was that the gravity that you like to see in sanitary, we couldn't get it. So what we ended up doing was running down the side of the building to the driveway, which again was messy and disruptive. It happened to work out because there was other work and other rationale for doing it that way. My understanding, and again, some others on the call might have their own experience, but there is pumps that are available for those types of things. If you're trying to get it, you know, pumped up, just like you would in some basements. But in our particular case, we ran the sanitary out to the front yard, tied it into the sanitary in the front yard before it went to into the city right of way. But that's, you know, typically for these properties, and Adam, you might be able to specifically confirm this, is they don't want to see multiple services tying in out at the city right of way.
Yeah, exactly that. It's basically a question of access and metering. And I certainly don't have a lot of the details around that. I'm not a servicing expert by any means. But from what I understand, effectively, if you were to say, bring in your water service from the main house, for example, and a pipe were to burst in the main house and the person in the main house were away or something like that, it could create a bunch of unwanted and unnecessary problems. So, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I hope that answers the question. There is a question here about, I think this might be also for Adam. Does the walkway need to be delineated, i.e. with gravel, paving stones, etc., or simply that there is a direct walking path from the ADU to the street, presumably via one side of the house? Does fencing matter? For example, if there is fencing between the street and the two units?
That's a great question. I'm not sure I actually know the answer to that. The bylaw basically says that the 1.1 meter unobstructed pathway must be provided between the street and the additional dwelling unit. Now, what the required surface treatment of that pathway is, I'm actually not certain. But if you'd like to send me a follow-up email, I can put you in touch with the people who know that exact detail and can let you know. My instinct is it probably has to be hardscape in some way, such that it's, you know, slip resistant or otherwise accessible. And certainly if the unit itself is accessible, is something we definitely encourage. And so a concrete or asphalt walkway would be preferred, because then anyone could use that additional dwelling unit. But the actual requirement, if you'd like to follow up, just send me an email and we'll get that sorted out. And fencing, I think, I don't believe you could have fencing obstructing the pathway. Because it is a fire safety issue. And so if there was an emergency response call, those personnel would have to be able to get to the unit without being obstructed, and a fence would presumably do that. So I would expect that it would have to be clear for that pathway, for access to that pathway.
Okay.
Good. Or even if I can add to that, yeah. What we've also encountered some clients is the 1.1 meter cannot encroach the drive, like a parking spot, because some people is like, oh, I have here my parking spot. So even though it's asphalt, you would still have to be clear of that. So whatever is the dimension, 2.something meters plus the 1.1 beside your parking spot.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I guess a little bit related to that then is, I guess here's another question for Adam. Is there an ability to widen an existing driveway to provide required parking? Concern is that many existing side yards are used to provide required parking for two cars and are quite narrow. About 2.6 meters and would not be wide enough for the 1.1 meter wide emergency access aisle with cars parked. So these are access questions.
Yeah, basically there's a whole bunch of options for how the parking can be laid out on site. And part of the review of the site plan from planning staff will be to determine whether or not that's functioning as intended. We certainly encourage tandem parking so that there is maybe not quite as much width of asphalt along the street. We certainly value trees and front yards and all that kind of stuff. But if the sort of the base bylaw allows that kind of width of driveway, then certainly it's possible to expand a driveway to accommodate that parking requirement. On the website link that I sent earlier, there are actually a couple of parking diagrams that show how we think you could probably fit either two or three cars on a property. And that might help provide a little bit of clarification, but ultimately the parking layout is sort of on a case-by-case basis. It's going to depend on where your garage is, if you have a garage, how deep the lot is, how deep the driveway is to the main house, how big the front yard setback is, all those kinds of things contribute. And so that's something we'll review through the site plan application and then approve, hopefully.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Good. And then here's a question, and it's a question that I actually personally had, is it possible to add a second floor unit to an existing two-car detached garage? Can stairs be exterior to the unit?
That's another really good question, and something where I might have to ask you to follow up with me to get the sort of specific feedback from the zoning experts themselves. But yes, I do generally think that is permissible, and that the additional dwelling unit above the garage would sort of have to meet the height restrictions and everything. So that might make it a little bit challenging, as well as certainly the floor area calculation. And I suspect maybe we might consider the entire outbuilding as that footprint. So the garage and the unit above may all have to fit within that requirement, but I actually don't know for sure. So again, please follow up with me and I will put you in touch with someone who can give you that exact answer.
Mm-hmm.
I might add to that from the technical side, we've reviewed a lot of these projects for laneway houses in Toronto, and I would say 90% of the time, the existing building can't actually support the second floor when we look at the foundations. The walls can, but the foundations aren't deep enough to meet code requirements for an actual house. They're perfectly fine for garage. So even a brand new garage won't necessarily be able to be converted to a house when we look through the code issues with it.
Mm-hmm. My question, yes, please, Graham.
So I can add to that too. Typically, if we're adding on top of a garage, we're almost all the time we are tearing down the existing garage to put in new foundations and then building the whole thing up again. We had done a number of that type of project though, typically with an attached garage, which makes it of course a lot easier because then it's not a detached dwelling, which would be the accessory dwelling. So, and in a couple of instances, we've attached the garage to the house in order to allow then the second story addition on top of the garage. So city doesn't like you doing that, but it works.
That's why we have architects, to be creative. I think that my related question to the garage question was that, I mean, there are a lot of existing detached garages, but typically they are not in compliance with the setbacks. And is it possible to convert one such structure to be an ADU without having to go for a variance because it's already existing? Is that something you can answer, Adam?
Sorry, can you repeat that? I was distracted briefly. I apologize.
That's okay. So, so if say you have a detached garage that is not in compliance with the required setback, it's an existing garage, can that be converted to an ADU without having to go for variances, et cetera?
I think you would likely have to apply for a minor variance through the Committee of Adjustment for that. The question is though, if it's an attached garage, then that may qualify as a duplex instead and may sort of run up against different zoning regulations in the overall, aside from the additional dwelling unit zoning. So I apologize for the complexity in all this stuff. I wish it was simpler than it is, but every case is unique and zoning's meant to kind of scoop up a lot of different things and try to make it viable. It's not really meant to be a case-by-case solution. So hopefully people understand that and come and talk to us and we'll help sort of sort out the solutions there.
Okay, great. Okay, I think we can get to one last question and it's directed to Matt Bolin. Can you explain cross-laminated timber for us?
Yes, happily. So cross-laminated timber is a product you see it used a lot in Europe, but it's definitely making its way into Canada. A very sustainable product in that it is, you know, sequestering carbon, and it's essentially, you know, the best way to think about it is plywood, structural plywood. So layers of dimension lumber that get glued together that you can actually use for their structural properties, both as walls, as floors, as roof panels. So for us, particularly working with that material, having some experience, and particularly having a local now supplier of the product out of St. Thomas in Element 5, which maybe some of the panels here, most of you have been to that plant. It's a really exciting and interesting product, again, for its sustainable impacts, for its biophilic impacts of, you know, being around natural materials. It's good. You can essentially expose your structure, which is something that you often can't do. It's great for actually having external waterproofing and insulation added onto the outside, which creates a really good building envelope, very, very passive house based, kind of perfect wall assembly that we like to work with. So what we're looking to do is take that product and figure out, you know, how we can make it and use it in a kit of parts type of approach that can be assembled, potentially prefabricated offsite, brought onto some of these small sites with challenges of getting through and back at them, and then assembling it that way. So that's mass timber. But definitely Google it and look up. There's lots of great material online as well.
Great, thank you. Okay, so we're at pretty much time here, and I would like to thank everyone, all our panelists, Andre, Matt, Adam, Anna, Daniel, Cyrus, Graham, Krista, and Ilhan, and of course, KPL for hosting this. Thank you to, hold on, I'm just gonna show the last slide here. Special thank you to the Architects Collaborative and Anna Gascon. She, wearing both hats as a GVSA executive and as the principal designer for the winning competition, put a lot of work into organizing this and getting it out to the public. And I hope that this webinar presentation has inspired a lot of you out there to venture to getting your own backyard home built. And I think that's pretty much it.
I would like to offer a big thank you to you, Yvonne, for coming out and moderating this event. It's been great. And I think a lot of people have thanked you already, Adam, but a big thanks to Adam Clark for providing some great information, working in his nighttime, his job on behalf of the city of Kitchener. Great to get the direct answers like that. And thank you so much for taking the lead on organizing this competition. Hopefully we will see more of these kind of events in Kitchener and everywhere.